Let's take a look at this bone. You have probably seen it, felt it, maybe even fractured it. It's the clavicle or collarbone. Now let's place it in context. Here it is on the human body, running horizontally from the base of the neck to the shoulder. It's the only long bone that lies horizontally and it sits right under the skin, superficially, easy to feel and yes, easy to injure. Anatomically, it connects the upper limb to the axial skeleton. This makes the clavicle an important part of the upper limb, alongside the scapula, humerus, radius, ulna, and the hand. It gives your upper arm freedom to move while protecting the underlying neurovascular bundle. So in this video, we're going to keep it simple. We will talk about the clavicle's parts, surface, basically its anatomy. We're going to cover the joints it forms, and then ask a simple question. Why do we even have a clavicle? Because what's fascinating is, some people are actually born without one, to which they can do this. And lastly, we will look at some clinical relevance, injuries, signs, and what to look out for when a patient walks in with a clavicle pain. What's up everyone, my name is Taim, I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you'd like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. Clavicle anatomy. It's so simple. The clavicle has three basic parts. First, we have the sternal end. It's the medial part, thicker and rounded, and it connects to the sternum. Then on the lateral side, we've got the acromial end. It's flatter and broader, and this is the part that meets the scapula at the acromium. And in between these two, there's the body of the clavicle, long, curved shaft. Now, let's place this clavicle in the body. At the acromial end, we will see the scapula, and specifically the acromium of the scapula. This is where the clavicle articulates laterally. Then on the other side, we can see the sternal end and the sternum. That's where the clavicle articulates medially. Alright, I assume it makes sense at this point. Let's expand on this. We will isolate the clavicle again, and then rotate it slightly in this direction. We will see this, the inferior surface. On the medial side, we can see a smooth surface called the sternal facet. That's where it meets the manubrium. Just below it, this rough patch is the impression for the costoclavicular ligament, which is involved in stabilizing the medial joint. I'll show you in a minute. But as we move across the body, this long groove is the subclavian groove, where the subclavius muscle sits and anchors. Then, as we move on to the lateral third, we can see the acromial facet, which is where the clavicle meets the acromium of the scapula. We can see the conoid tubercle and the trapezoid line. These are the attachment points for the conoid and the trapezoid ligaments, which are essentially parts of the costoclavicular ligaments. So that's the general layout of the clavicle. It's very simple. Let's now move on to the joints it forms. There are two joints. On the medial end, the clavicle is attached to the sternum through the sternoclavicular joint. And on the lateral end, it's attached to the acromium of the scapula through the acromioclavicular joint. Let's now focus on the sternoclavicular joint for a moment. The sternoclavicular joint is a joint where the articulating head is the sternal facet of the clavicle, and the articulating fossae is the clavicular notch of the sternum. These two together form the articular surfaces of the sternoclavicular joint. Now I will remove those labels and let's look at the supporting ligaments that stabilize this joint. Just below, you can see the costoclavicular ligament connecting the inferior surface of the clavicle to the first rib. Above that, running horizontally across the top, is the interclavicular ligament linking both clavicles across the jugular notch. And right here in the front, attaching the clavicle to the sternum, is the anterior sternoclavicular ligament. Now, let's shift over to the acromioclavicular joint on the lateral end of the clavicle. First, we see the acromioclavicular ligament. This ligament spans from the clavicle to the acromium, and it plays an important role in stabilizing the joint. It reinforces what we call the joint capsule, which is a fibrous envelope that surrounds and seals the joint space. Next, we see the coracoacromial ligament, which goes from the coracoid process of the acromium. This doesn't connect to the clavicle, but it forms a kind of an arch above the shoulder joint. This arch acts like a roof, preventing the humeral head from moving upwards out of space. Then we look below the clavicle and find two ligaments that suspend it from the coracoid process. Together, they form the coracoclavicular ligament. But they have two distinct parts. The trapezoid ligament is more lateral, running almost horizontally. The coronoid ligament is more medial and runs vertically. These two work together to prevent the clavicle from displacing upwards, keeping the shoulders stable, especially when you lift heavy things or brace during a fall. So overall, these structures form the support system for the lateral end of the clavicle. They anchor it in the scapula and keep the shoulders suspended in space. So those are the major joints and the general anatomy of the clavicle. So why do we have a clavicle? Well, the clavicle is important because it serves as a protective barrier for the major neurovascular structures running underneath it, like the brachial plexus, subclavian artery, and the subclavian vein. It acts like a shield, keeping those structures safe while giving them space. Without the clavicle, these structures would be more exposed to compressions or trauma. Around it, muscle anchor in from every direction. Anteriorly, like pectoralis major and subclavius, superiorly, like sternocleidomastoid, and posteriorly, trapezius. Even deltoid pulls on it from the lateral side. So the clavicle also works as a muscular anchor and help transmit forces between the upper limb and trunk. But more than just a shield or anchor, the clavicle gives the upper limb its positioning and reach. And for that, we describe it as acting like a strut. So what is a strut? A strut is, well, imagine this. You've got a car wheel and the body of the car. These two things need to stay a certain distance apart, and they need to stay stable, even when the wheel hits a bump or turns. They do that by adding a supportive rod. That's the strut. It helps keep the wheel in position and absorbs the forces from the road so everything doesn't collapse or shake apart. Now, let's replace the car with the sternum. The scapula is like the wheel, and the clavicle connects them, holding the scapula and your entire upper limb out and away from your chest. This isn't just about distance, it's about protecting your arm while allowing it to move freely. Notice how the clavicle is S-shaped. This adds resilience by helping it act like a shock absorber. How? Let's say you're doing a handstand or falling onto an outstretched arm. This impact travels through the arm, shoulder, scapula, clavicle, and then the sternum. So the clavicle helps distribute and dampen that force. And without the clavicle, you lose that structural bridge, and your shoulders may become hypermobile, even unstable. In conditions like cleidocranial dysplasia, patients who don't have a collarbone can bring their shoulders together in the front of the chest. Cool trick, but it shows how vital the clavicle is for the shoulder stability. Now, we said that this S shape gives the clavicle its stability to absorb force, but it also makes it vulnerable. The curve creates a natural weak point, which is usually in the middle third, where it's thinnest and not well protected by muscle. That's why this is the most common site of clavicle fractures. Clavicle fractures are very common, especially in sport injuries or traffic accidents. They account for about 5% of all adult fractures, and it most commonly happens when the person falls on an outstretched hand or a direct blow to the shoulder. That force travels up through the arm and the clavicle snaps under pressure. And when the clavicle breaks, the medial fragment is often pulled upwards by the sternocleidomastoid, and the lateral fragment drops downwards and forward because of the weight of the arm and the pull from the deltoid and the gravity. And since it's so close to the surface, you will often see a clear deformity of the skin as well. So let's say a patient comes in complaining of pain in the area of the clavicle. What should go through your mind? Think differential diagnosis. Well, the clavicle is involved in surprisingly broad range of conditions. First off, trauma is a big one. Think clavicle fractures, common in falls, direct hits to the shoulder, or sport injuries. Most fractures happen in the middle third of the bone, right where it's structurally weakest due to its S shape and lack of muscular coverage. But pain here isn't always a break. It could also be acromioclavicular joint injuries, sprains, dislocations, or even osteoarthritis from overuse or repetitive motion, especially in manual workers or weightlifters. That condition is also known as distal clavicular osteolysis, and it tends to creep up with vague pain during shoulder use. Another possibility is a sternoclavicular joint issue. It's rare, but when they show up, they can be serious. Dislocations, arthritis, or even infections in that joint can present as medial clavicle pain. And in young patients, growth plates, irritations, or congenital conditions like cleidocranial dysplasia could be on your radar if they are hypermobile or have unusual anatomy. So, what clinical signs do we look for? The patient might report a pop or crack during the trauma, or they will guard the arm, holding it in place. Look for deformity, tenderness to palpation, or swelling along the bone. If it's a fracture, often the medial end is pulled upwards by the sternocleidomastoid, while the lateral end drops due to gravity and muscle pull. It's quite dramatic. For AC joint problems, we use the cross-body adduction test. Pain means positive. If it's a fracture, palpation alone might tell you everything, but always check for neurovascular signs, radial pulls, cap refill, sensory deficits, especially if there's suspicion of posterior dislocation or severe trauma. For imaging, start with standard AP x-ray of the clavicle. For joint problems or subtle fractures, CT can give you more details. If you're suspicious of soft tissue or cartilage issues, like in osteolysis, MRI helps. And in high energy trauma, chest imaging might be needed to rule out rib fractures or pneumothorax. There's piano key test, where you just push down the AC joint to confirm dislocation. There's O'Brien's test, and so on. Treatment depends on the cause. Most mid-chap clavicle fractures are treated conservatively with a sling, rest, and physio. But if it's displaced, shortened, or tenting the skin, you may need surgical fixation, especially in athletes or active patients. AC joint injuries are often graded. Low grades, type 1 and 2, are treated with rest, ice, and NSAIDs, while higher grades, type 3 and above, might need surgery, particularly in those with persistent instability. For osteoarthritis or osteolysis, it's usually about activity modification, NSAIDs, physiotherapy, and occasional injections. If those don't work, a distal clavicle excision, either open or arthroscopic, can be done to relieve the pain. So that was everything I had for the clavicle. It's a pretty interesting bone, and also the most proximal bone of the upper limb. In the next video, we will be covering the whole anatomy of the scapula, and throw in a few clinical notes as well. Click on the next video and I will see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.